Welcome, welcome, welcome back to the Bob Lefsetz podcast. My guest today is Marshall Chess. Marshall, when did you realize your father was in the record business?
Oh, God, when I was maybe, 1940, 50, I would be 8 or 10 years old when he first started. He used to bring home the records, you know, when he first started, which was 1947. But I really knew in 1950 when Chess started. Then I knew. That was much more. Because he still had a nightclub when he started called the Macambo Lounge. And the company that he bought to turn into Chess was called Aristocrat Records. And he started working as a salesman. He wanted to learn. So from 1947 to 1950, while the nightclub still existed, my uncle came back from the army. He worked as a salesman for Aristocrat Records, whatever that meant. I never even discussed that with him, but that's what it says. He was a salesman. And then in 1950, he formed Chess Records and started. Actually, my father was a workaholic always. So I hardly saw him. I was the first and only son. I was desperate to play. He never played ball. Right? He was an immigrant that came over in 1922. So we weren't playing ball. It wasn't the typical American thing. He was always at work. And, I knew that was my way to him was through the family business, through work.
Let's start there. Okay. Your father was an immigrant. Your mother, was she born in the States? Was she an immigrant too?
My mother was born in the States from immigrant parents.
How'd your parents meet?
They met in Chicago. Evidently, the real story was my father had a girlfriend. He was in his early 20s. He had a girlfriend from a wealthier Jewish family that the father made her not see my father because he was an immigrant peasant. But my father really loved her. And I guess he met my mother. It was on the rebound. And they had a really close friend that both my father and this guy, Marty Witzel, worked at a shoe store called Burger Shoe Store. Shoe guys. It was a big, big, giant shoe store where everyone got discount, cheaper, Jewish kind of business. And they got married. My mother and father and this guy, Marty and Millie, they had a double wedding. And they got married together. They were very close friends. And that's how it began. You know, I've seen early photos of them horseback riding in the park in Chicago. But yeah, they got married very young. That's how they met, you know, through my father didn't like working in the shoe store. He was a milkman before that. He hated working for people. He instilled that in me very much so. So I know, and I instilled it in my son and my daughter. So I know how that goes when you instill young. But he didn't want to work for people. So in Chicago, we got to go back to a million black people came up from on the Illinois Central from Memphis, primarily from Mississippi, Arkansas, Tennessee, Kentucky, into Chicago to make money. They could not make money in the South. It was short not before civil rights, not long after slavery. It was very difficult. World War II hit and the factories in Chicago, it became like a bloodline for making money. So they, immigrants, black immigrants, along with Irish, Polish Jews, they all came to Chicago at the same time. And it was really an immigrant center. So my father, that black people they couldn't get a storefront. They didn't have bank accounts. Young people don't understand that. No bank accounts, no storefront, didn't know anything about business. And my father and my uncle both heard black. My grandfather, Joe Chess, came 7 years prior to America with relatives.
Okay, just one sec. What was the name in the old country and how did it become Chess?
Chez, C-Z-Y-Z, Chez. And in Ellis Island, they changed my grandfather they must have said, but, you know, what's your name? You know, Joseph Chez. Ah, Chess now. And that was it. That's how it started.
Okay, so your grandfather came 7 years before your father.
7 years prior with some relatives in Chicago. A guy was a carpenter. part of the family from a small village in on the Poland. Right now, it's Belarus. It was right where all this trouble is now in Ukraine, right on the border. It was Poland then. And he came from this small village, Mutl, a Jewish little tavern. They had a tavern in town. It was a village on the road. My grandfather was a traveling cobbler, shoemaker, whatever he would fix. And he came to Chicago, and he came and he earned the money to bring over the family 7 years later on the Lusitania, that same boat that picked up people from the Titanic.
Wow.
They came from Southampton to Chicago, to New York. Southampton, a train from Poland, I guess, and then to Southampton to New York, train to Chicago. My uncle said when he got to London, to the Southampton, he never had an inside toilet. He didn't know how to flush it. It was a chain, you know, one of those from the ceiling. He didn't know it. That was the first toilet he saw. But anyway, they came because they didn't know English. And my grandfather was like a stern kind of guy. I heard later in life that he was a child beater with a belt. You know, he used to really punish.
Father beat me with a belt, so.
Yeah, my father beat me up really bad once. You know how they say that gets inherited. He did really bad one time, but aside from that. So my grandfather evolved to a junkyard. Then it was a scrap metal yard. And my uncle said that part of their big business was getting empty old bottles on the street. They'd sell to Al Capone's bootleg brewery to rebottle. My uncle said, Al gave me $100 when I went into the army. He said, Al gave me $100 and a free pass in his whorehouse. But we checked it, my son and I, and that's impossible. It was like 10 years difference. But it was someone that was still that going on in Chicago. It was someone, you know. So anyway, across from that junkyard was a black church, the old kind with an upright piano, tambourines, and a bass drum. And they heard the gospel singing, and they were fascinated because my uncle would tell me. My uncle was the guy who told you all the real stories. My father was about business, you know, making sure that you could handle life, not the old stories. But anyway, my uncle said, yeah, man, we'd heard this black singing, and we'd stand there, and we'd listen fascinated to the music, and we'd come home late, and Zadie would beat us with his belt, the grandfather, for being late for dinner. But in the village in Poland, evidently one guy had a wind-up Victrola, and when he'd play it, like half the town would come under the window to hear that, you know, to hear music. I don't think it doesn't sound like they had any live music in that little village. And so that's how that began. So he was around black people right from the beginning before he spoke English. You know, it was in the ghetto, where the church was, where the junkyard was. And anyway, when he wanted to go on his own, he found out through the grapevine or whatever that white guys, you could get a really cheap lease for a storefront in the ghetto if you were white.
Wait, now, this is your grandfather.
My father.
Clear, your grandfather came, your grandfather was working in the junkyard, and your father worked there too.
Yeah, my father worked there too, and then he left. My grandfather closed the junkyard, evidently, and he had earned enough. He bought some rundown apartment building, and he made it into sort of ghetto apartment buildings, a few of them. Actually, my uncle lived in one, so it wasn't so bad, you know.
Okay, so when did the shoe store come, before or after he got the store?
The shoe store came way after. That's already after high school.
Okay, so he gets a storefront. Keep going.
He gets a storefront on South State Street, right on the edge of the black ghetto, where, you know, still the ghetto, but right on the south side of Chicago. And he opens Cut-Rate Liquors. And he sees that on weekends, the Eagle Flies on Friday, that famous blues song. He sees that they're coming in like crazy to buy booze, you know, to party. He loves it. He sees that's a business. He learns black culture. He learns how to talk to the customers. He works by himself 15, 18 hours a day. That's the kind of guy he was, always. And
my father owned a liquor store, too. Same thing.
There you go.
Same thing in the black area of Bridgeport, Connecticut.
So he quickly moved to 2 years later to a corner. This is the story. I've heard a couple of versions, but I'll tell you the version that I want to believe. He moved to the 708 Club 2 years later, maybe 1945 or 6. And I was a little kid then, 3 or 4. I was born in 42.
So okay, like, but just a couple old. Of questions. World War II is happening. How does he not
end yeah, up? My uncle went. My uncle went off. My uncle went off to the Aleutian Islands. My dad could not get drafted. He wore a brace on his left leg, a leather brace from some, you know, some village disease, probably polio, rheumatic fever. They don't know. And to get into America, they had to throw the brace overboard, and he had to walk straight. Wow. They didn't let cripples in. You know, cripples had to go to another line in that era. So he couldn't go to the army. That kept him out. And, you know, coincidentally, I've had back surgery, and I lost the nerve in my left leg, and now it's thin like his. It's so bizarre. You know, it could be stranger things happen, I guess. So I have a thin leg now. But you could only notice it a little bit if you had a bathing suit on. It wasn't drastic. Anyway, yeah, so then he had the club, the 708, and there was a jukebox. So not only he got the booze, he sees they're dropping nickels. That was what it was at 5 cents a play. Nickels like crazy, along with the booze. And he said, music, booze. You know, he was a success-oriented guy. He felt, and I think he was insecure around white people then. I think he felt, being an immigrant, I think he felt a very symbiotic security with the black people. I always felt that. I mean, you know, we always had black friends there way before, man. My bar mitzvah was the first interracial event in Chicago, you know, really. Party. I mean, it was, but anyway, I always felt as I got older and learned about psychology that maybe he was a little insecure, you know, being an immigrant and all that. But anyway, he opened the club, and then he got a license. The next thing was in 1945, I guess I read in this well-researched book called Spinning Blues into Gold. It's still online. Really well researched. I guess he got a license for the Macambo Lounge, which was his nightclub. It had a stage, Bob's Ribs in the back. You could get ribs. It became a live music. There was a guy, Tibbs, I forget his first name, Alan Tibbs, played a saxophone. It was a house band, bar, long bar. I was only in there one time. I have my famous Marshall story. My father takes me there, picks me up at the house. Again, I only was around him if I had to go to work. So he picks, we lived at 44th and Drexel, which was on the edge of, in a third floor walk up. But it was a Polish, Irish, Jewish neighborhood. But eight blocks north was the black line, where the black, you know, so that's where the club was, 12, 14 blocks away, the Macambo Lounge. And then my dad picked me up, and it was in the night, early, 7, 8 o'clock at night. They used to take turns when my uncle came back from the army. He came back while the club was still working. And I walked in with my dad holding, I was little, man, you know, and there was gunshot. And he threw me over the bar to my uncle, who was the bartending. And my uncle laid me down on these horrible wooden slats that were on the floor and laid on top of me to protect me. To this day, the smell of rotten alcohol and scum, that, you know, my face was pressed, now I can remember the smell. And that was my first time there, man. And then, you know, whatever it was, the problem ended, and they took me home, you know. I don't remember the details, but I sure remember that he threw me over the counter, you know. It was a rough club. One of the oldest employees, this guy, Gene Ross, who was big 6'5" guy who was half black and half Cherokee Indian. He loved federal prisons. He always got in trouble for, he was a drug, but he worked for my father as a bouncer. And the reason he was always around during that Macambo time, a guy came after my father with a knife, and Big Gene jumped in front and took the knife. Wow. And after that, he always had a job when he was out of prison. Even when my dad had a DeSoto from that, at the time of the club, my mother was crying. His first new car, a DeSoto, was a Chrysler car at the time. Chrysler owned it. That Gene got busted. He had heroin in the glove compartment, and the feds confiscated the car. And my dad was freaked. And Gene, of course, went to prison again. I saw him all the way to when I worked with the Rolling Stones. When we toured Chicago, he found Jesus. He became a religious guy. But yeah, he found me during the concert. I couldn't believe it. I went to the sidelines and saw him, and he had people, you know, he was a big guy. They fine martial chess. Yeah. He was good. But he had the club. And then, someone came in to record. I think Aristocrat was owned by many people. And he just, again, perked up. He went from the liquor store to the corner tavern to a nightclub. Now, black people, music, record business. What's the record business? And my father, he became a salesman to learn it, to see what it was about. And coincidentally, one of the artists, and it wasn't a black label. It was 78s, and they had folk music, all kinds of different artists. But one of the artists was Muddy Waters. At that time, he was a truck driver as well. His name was McKinley Morganfield, but he was already well-known from Alan Lomax, the famous he was the guy who recorded all the music in the South. He had recorded Muddy for historical recording from the cotton fields. What was the name of that plantation? He actually lived on a plantation. He used to tell me he'd catch fish for a nickel of fish and how he would, all kinds of stories. His first guitar strings were on the wall of the cabin that he ran strings to strum. He was the closest of the artists to me because he was my father's true friend. They grew together. He said there was a radio show when my dad died because we owned a radio station then, WVON, the voice of the Negro, the first modern black radio station in America, first black news director, et cetera, et cetera. But Muddy said, Leonard Chess was a true friend. He would have said, I made Chess, and I would have said, Leonard made me. They had this, and these were hits. 10,000, 12,000 was a giant blues hit. This is not million sellers. So misconstrued by people as time goes on, 2 cents of publishing was 2 cents royalty. It was a whole other thing. There were no giant hits then. The first hit we had was in 1955 when rock and roll broke with Chuck Berry and Bo Diddley. That was a big year. That was my 13 bar mitzvah. The hits, first money started rolling in, and everything changed in my life. I took my son, who's a third generation record man, Jamar Chess. It's a thrill to see that he's carrying it on his own as well. But he wanted to meet Chuck Berry. So he was on his farewell tour, and he was in his 80s. He was playing at B.B. King's Club in Chicago. So I took him, and Chuck and I were friends. I was his road manager when he came out of prison. I knew him well. So I took my son backstage, and I said to him, it was like an emotional thing. I don't know. It brings up my father and everything. So I said to Chuck, I never told you this, but man, 1955, when I was 13, you changed my life. I got a Schwinn 3-speed bicycle. We moved out of that walk-up apartment. Everything changed, with Maybelline, 1955. And he said, what are you talking about? He took my hand and his eyes were watering up. He said, what are you talking about? You changed mine in 1955. what a beautiful moment. And my son heard that, it was beautiful. Yeah.
Okay, so your father becomes a salesman. When he's a salesman, he sells the club. He's out of the club already?
No, not out of the club. I can, now that everyone's dead, no one's going to sue me. No. In 1950, right before he bought Chess Records, strangely enough, the club burned down. With a really nice insurance policy. And my uncle, again, said, yeah, those motherfuckers, the firemen were passing out cases of liquor. They weren't fighting the fucking fire, and we didn't say a word. And then I actually remember my dad didn't trust banks. I remember it's vague, but I'll tell you, maybe, it was just for color. I don't think he cashed the check from the insurance and brought it home in cash, and it was all laid out on the bed, $100 bill. And that's what he used to buy them out to buy Chess Records. The Macombo went down.
So first it was Aristocrat Records. Tell me how it ends up becoming Chess.
He bought them out. After 2 years of being a salesman and wanting to go in the record business, they offered Evelyn. Her name was Evelyn, who was one of the owners from the beginning. She had been married twice. I have a feeling even my father and her had a, just my own idea from the, that they had a thing. But she ended up getting married for a second time or so and wanted to get out of the business, wanted to sell it. They wanted to sell it. And so he inherited that, the late, you know, he bought it because Muddy Waters was on it, you know, he bought it. Whatever, I don't know the cost or anything. I have no idea.
And then they renamed it Chess Records.
Yeah, no, they renamed it because they had, my father had, the, one of the record pressers for Aristocrat was a guy out of Memphis, one of the first pressing plants in America, named Buster Williams. Buster used to fly up. He flew a twin Cessna, a Southern gentleman. He was, but somehow him and my father had this great relationship. And Buster is the one, when my dad told him, you'll be my presser. I'm buying Aristocrat. I want to change your name. He suggested, why don't you just call it Chess Records? And that was from Buster. And he was a family friend with the, we were always in the pressing business too, from him. He was the, and we had such a unique thing. I mean, we'll talk later, but at the end, we had this 8-story building that had three studios, full record pressing plant, injection pressing, printing and plating. You could come in, you could make it. It was never been something like that. It was the old Wollensack recorder building that in Chicago, and it was a manufacturing building. And we had this fabulous, unbelievable, with an elevator. They had a rooftop sauna where they were bringing their girlfriends. They had like a whole rooftop sauna, barbershop, all, you know, the guys who built the building. And we bought that building, so it was all under one roof. But we always, the problem with the independent, there weren't a lot of independent pressing plants. So when the independent record business broke, if five labels had hits at one time, you couldn't always get your product. And so owning a plant was important. My father thought that was an important thing. And we could press for the other guys when they were having hits. But we started with a very small plant. I actually worked the press when I was 16. I was raised to be a record man, a record boy. I've been told that I went on the road the first time when I was 13 through the South. My dad, we arrived in New Orleans. I met the famous Cosmo. My dad gave me a $10 bill. He said, I'll see you tonight. I tell my wife that your mother let you wander around New Orleans at 10? $10 was like 50 then, too. Yeah, I went to 3 movies. I ate like a pig. I did it. He ran. I was always an independent soul. He always, you know.
Okay, let's thread a few needles. So you got in business with the guy in Memphis. Was he partners in the pressing plant?
No, Buster just owned the pressing plant, but he was going to be our presser for the whole country.
Okay, they were so friends. What was your
they
father's-
were friends from the Aristocrat. He pressed Aristocrat. Chess Records, the foundation of rock and roll, blues, jazz, gospel, soul. See the faces that made Chess Records one of the most seminal record labels in the world. In this fabulous new Chess tribute book, available on Amazon and other fine bookstores.
So what were the first records, and then what was the first big hit?
The first Chess session, I actually went again. I wanted to be around my dad. Before we built our own studios in Chicago, we had one famous great recording. It was called Universal Recording. They ended up becoming Bill Putnam. Maybe he opened this, became famous making studio equipment, limiters and stuff for the studios. The first was Gene Ammons, My Foolish Heart. I have it framed here on a 78 in my cabin. I slept on 3 metal folding chairs. My dad took me to the studio to see that. That was the first one. And it was Chess 4750. 4750 Karlov was their first apartment in America. He was superstitious about shit. And that I inherited, because when I did this, I had my own label, the psychedelic label, Cadet Concept. The first record I did was 312, my father's birthday. We were always in, you know, again, the black, early black culture, you know, it came from Africa, man. It was voodoo, mojo, man, all that. And my father very much was exposed to the whole kind of, you know, superstition. I mean, just as a sidebar, since we're talking about it, when I was maybe in high school, 17, when Buddy Guy, the famous blues guy now, was a studio guy. He was going back to Mississippi, and I asked him to bring me a mojo so I could get girls. And he brought me this little pink bag. It smelled like of the cheapest Woolworth perfume, and it had like pig bristles sticking out of it, like bristles, you know? And you'd pin it to the white t-shirt everyone wore. I pinned it when I went
to soccer. Well, did it work?
You know, in that era, if you're lucky, you touched a bra strap. You know, no, it didn't work, you know.
Okay, you so know, your
you
father...
Touched the, you touched the top of a brassiere, you were bragging to your buddies. You know?
So your father and your uncle are producing these records too, right?
Learning how to produce? Yeah, producing.
So they didn't know what they were doing. They just, what, turned on the machine?
They didn't know what they were doing, but no, if they didn't keep things moving, it would collapse. How do I know that? Because in I produced my first album in 1962. I was 20 years old. When I was 18 or 19, I worked always, every summer. I just loved it. I wanted being there. I loved it. My dad said to me, they used to record, the studio was on the second floor. My dad would say, he said, go up to the studio. I have to go to a meeting. No, your uncle's not here. I said, do what? You know, he said, just tell the motherfuckers to take another one. I said, what? He said, look, if you don't tell them to take another one, they're going to sit around talking about pussy and jobs. Nothing's going to get done. He said, one of those takes is going to be a mother. He said, we said motherfucker a lot in my family. That one of those takes is going to be a motherfucker. And that's what I did. So that's how he learned. That's exactly what I'm saying. Take another one. But another thing I learned from my father, I still do it today. I'm producing a record right now with a partner. Surround yourself. Make symbiotic relationships of stuff you don't know, like great. It'll be better. So he surrounded himself with people who knew music and then watched and learned from them. The first guy that was the closest was his famous Willie Dixon, the blues writer, producer, bass player. He'd get all the bands together. He would co-produce, really, all those early sessions with my father. But little by little, my father learned how to produce. What he really learned was what made records sell, because we weren't making art, we were making singles, and everyone, artists, all of us wanted hits. It was all about making money. Artists didn't care about art then. They all wanted the hit. They came to chess because they wanted, we got radio play, we paid off disc jockeys, we got hits, you know? So, you know, my father learned. I mean, he was very responsible. He was very responsible for so much in rock and roll. His studio nickname was the Foot Stomper. That's because he wanted that strong backbeat. He would stomp his foot. He even played bass drum on a blues record once to show him what he wanted. So when Chuck Berry died, you know, I don't know, 8 or 10 years ago, his wife asked me to speak at his funeral in St. Louis. I said, of course. I knew him well. Everyone else is dead, really, that knew him directly. I went, and it was amazing, like 500 people in this big auditorium, and they treat him like Mozart in St. Louis. I mean, he's very famous. I did my spiel with speech. The governor was in line with me. This was a major thing. His family was all sitting there nodding, and, you know, me when I was speaking, telling stories. So then there was a break to pull out the casket. He had like 20 all-white Cadillacs with motorcycles. It was amazing. And I'm standing, it was a hot, sunny day, and I see this, like, I could tell he was well-dressed. I could tell he was a Jewish guy leaning on the same post, we're waiting. And he says, who are you? And I said, I'm Marshall Chuck. Oh, I know you, your father. I'm Chuck's lawyer, you know, da, da, da. And he tells me, you know, all about Chuck and this lawyer. Then another guy, a black man, came up to me and he said, Mr. Chess, he said, I got to tell you something. You probably don't know. I heard you speaking there. You know your daddy. I was there. I went with Chuck when he made Maybelline in Chicago. You know, it was your daddy who kept pushing for the beat, and it was your daddy who turned up the echo. Chess Records, the foundation of rock and roll, blues, jazz, gospel, soul, see the faces that made Chess Records one of the most seminal record labels in the world in this fabulous new Chess tribute book, available on Amazon and other fine bookstores. Thanks for listening. See you at the next podcast. Come on, check out our video channel and please subscribe.